We've been dealing primarily with DC, direct current voltages and currents. At least two reasons for this are apparent. First, DC voltages and currents are simple and straightforward. A DC electric potential will be at the same potential whether we test it now, 10 minutes from now, or 2 days from now. Second, DC signals often provide the power for AC, alternating current circuits. Circuits that amplify time-varying signals, for example, cannot make signals larger without having energy to add to the signal. Conservation of energy is one of those things that cannot be violated. The energy from the DC portion of the circuit sets the stage for the time-varying signal to be amplified. Voltages or currents that vary in time are a bit more interesting. They can take many forms, from the response of a primarily DC system between the time it is off and the time it is steadily on, this would be called the transient response, to a signal that varies in time with a regular pattern, like a sinusoidal wave. Voltages that vary in time in a regular pattern are called periodic signals. That means if we know the period of time over which a periodic signal occurs, we know it will be at the same potential at every multiple of that time interval for every time t. Though these signals change in time, they change in a repeating pattern, so their behavior is predictable for all of time. All of time may be a bit overstated, but it is the language we use. What we really mean is for any time we could possibly be interested. A special case of predictable signals are sinusoids. Sinusoids include sine and cosine functions. These are probably what we think of when we think of a classical wave. Not only are these functions special in their periodicity, they have a bunch of interesting mathematical properties that were worked out by some amazing historical figures. Not the least of these properties is that all periodic functions can be constructed by adding sine waves together. I do not think the importance of these functions can be overemphasized. With that, let's begin our journey into the alliterative realm of sinusoidal steady-state analysis. As the name implies, sinusoidal steady-state analysis deals with sinusoids that are constant in amplitude and frequency. That is the steady-state part. Just to make sure we're all on the same page, let's go over some terminology pertaining to sinusoids. If we look at a cosine function, the obvious attributes of the wave are its height, which we refer to as the amplitude, and its period, which is the time it takes for the wave to complete a cycle. In general, we do not use the period of a wave in equations or conversation, but instead describe waves in terms of frequency. The frequency of a wave is the inverse of the period and is a measure of how many times per second the wave repeats. The terminology we use for this is cycles per second, which is the unit of hertz. Frequency gives us an intuitive description of the wave, but is not necessarily the best mathematical description. Cyclical motion can be discussed in terms of circles, and the motion around the circle can be described in terms of the angle. The standard unit for angular motion is the radian. The definition of the radian is the angle traversed while sweeping an arc length equal to the radius of the circle. This leads to our unit of cyclical behavior, which is the radian per second, where angular frequency is equal to 2 pi times the cyclical frequency, which is usually just called frequency. A generalized cosine function would then be described in terms of some amplitude, A, times the cosine of the angular frequency multiplied times time. Cosine is an even function, so it is symmetric around time equals zero, as the graph shows. Sine is a very similar function. The only difference is that the wave is shifted on the time axis. In fact, we can convert a sine wave to a cosine function by subtracting pi over 2 from the original argument. This factor of pi over 2 is the phase shift, because it shifts the function on the time axis. Another way to think about it might be that the cosine function happens first on the time axis, so to be equal to the sine function, we need to adjust the argument. This adjustment is called the phase angle. Now I have to try to explain one of the weird things electrical engineers do with these functions. The angular frequency times times portion of the argument has units of radians, so the phase angle has to be stated in radians in order to calculate a value for the function. However, radians are not the most intuitive units for us to use when it comes to angles. If someone tells me that an angle is 0.4 radians, it's not immediately obvious to my mind how large of an angle we're talking about. However, if they were to tell me the angle was 23 degrees, I would have a pretty good guess as to the size of the angle. The angular frequency is nevertheless better described with units of radians per second. So we keep that unit. However, phase angles are usually written with units of degrees. The units of the argument are then the angular frequency in radians per second times time in seconds plus the phase angle in degrees. This is mixed notation and is mathematically and technically improper. So great care must be taken if we need to evaluate these functions at a particular point in time. If for some reason an instantaneous value is needed, we need to remember to convert the phase angle to units of radians. What is cool is now we have a generalized time-based sinusoidal function. Any single frequency sinusoidal function can be described in terms of a magnitude, xm, times a cosine of omega t plus phi. This would be everything we would need if we did not have components that could change the phase angle of our electrical signals. But we do. So we need a description of a wave that handles phase shifts and handles them in a reasonable fashion. A more complete generalized sinusoidal signal is represented by the complex exponential representation, Vm e to the j omega t plus phi, which is equal to Vm cosine of omega t plus phi plus jVm sine of omega t plus phi. A generalized cosine wave is then just the in-phase portion, or mathematically the real part of the complex sinusoid. Truth be told, complex sinusoids have always troubled me. I had difficulty in grasping what the so-called imaginary portion of the signal represented. And then, if we really want to mess with our heads, we can use Euler's formula to write cosine and sine in terms of complex exponential functions. Then we have to deal with the idea of negative frequency. What does that even mean? And what do we do when we come across quantities that we have no idea how to process? The first thing I would suggest is to trust the thousands of brilliant people who have dealt with this before know what they're talking about. I'm not saying not to question anything, but give them the benefit of the doubt. After that, we can try to wrap our heads around what these quantities might represent. Let's look at how complex numbers might relate to reality. When it comes to real and imaginary representations of a sinusoidal signal, I'm quite certain most of the difficulty has to do with the term imaginary. The term imaginary screws our brains up because we think imaginary things do not actually exist. Sometimes real things behave in unexpected ways. Consider a cosine wave. At time equals zero, the cosine function is equal to 1. By the time the argument reaches pi over 2, the cosine function is equal to 0. Most of the time when a physical quantity reaches 0, it's done. That's not the case with a cosine function, which is actually equal to 0 2 times every cycle. Maybe this is easiest if we think of a cosine function in terms of a rotating dot. The dot moving in a counterclockwise circle generates a cosine function in time when it starts on the positive horizontal axis. Thinking back to our discussion of complex numbers, we called the horizontal axis the real axis and the vertical axis the imaginary axis. We might begin to see the relationship between a complex number moving in a circle, a phasor, and a cosine function. When we are rotated to pi over 2, the corresponding complex number is entirely imaginary. The real part is 0. We know the cosine is going to continue on. By the time we are rotated to pi, the cosine is entirely real again, it is just negative, and the cycle will continue. If we were to throw the function out every time the real part became 0, we would lose information. In the case of an electrical signal, that would mean energy would disappear. Impossible. Another observation we can make is that the rotation does not have to start on the real axis to generate the same shaped curve. The only difference would be the starting rotation or phase of the signal. When we break a function down into real and imaginary components, all we are really saying is that some circuits can phase shift a cosine function. In our context, it turns out that things that can shift a cosine function are devices that can store energy. The in-phase components of a sinusoidal function correspond to components that can use energy. The out-of-phase components correspond to things that can store energy. The capacitor is an example of this. The current through a capacitor is equal to the capacitance times the derivative of the voltage with respect to time. So if the voltage is represented by a cosine signal, the current will be represented by a negative sine signal. But from what we have already seen, a negative sine signal is just a cosine that is shifted by negative 90 degrees. Current and voltage being 90 degrees out of phase is going to correspond to energy storage. If we were only dealing with a single cosine wave that was the same everywhere in the system, we could treat it pretty much as a DC signal that wiggles. However, once we put the signal into a system where phase shift of the sinusoids can be different in different parts of the circuit, it becomes necessary to keep track of the phase shifts. This is accomplished by keeping track of both the in-phase portion of the signal and the out-of-phase portion of the signal. This is what we're doing when we do sinusoidal steady-state analysis, which we normally refer to as phasor analysis. By definition, phasor analysis only applies to systems that have a single frequency present. That is not as limiting as it might seem for a couple of reasons. One is that the frequency of a first order system is constant. Another is that the most common distortion of frequency in the system is to add harmonics or multiples of the fundamental frequency. In that case, we can still analyze the fundamental frequency and then analyze the harmonic frequencies. This is valid because of superposition. All that being said, starting from the complex sinusoid, let's get to the phasor. We can see that our generalized time domain cosine function is just the real part of the complex sinusoid. If we rewrite the complex sinusoid as two separate exponential functions, we can arrange it so that we have a portion containing the magnitude and phase of the function, and another portion which contains information about the angular frequency. The portion containing information about the magnitude and phase is what we call the phasor. A phasor voltage, for example, contains information about the magnitude and phase angle of the voltage. We leave information about the angular frequency of the sinusoid out of our phasor representation. That does not mean the angular frequency is not important. In fact, angular frequency is critically important in sinusoidal steady-state analysis. We will see in the near future that once we account for the angular frequency, we can leave it out of our equations. That is simply because we're dealing with a single frequency system, so the e to the j omega t term would be everywhere in every equation, so it can simply be factored out. Once we're in the phasor notation, we are in a new domain of analysis. The idea of domains is very important. When things are expressed in the time domain, one form of analysis applies. When they are in the phasor domain, another form of analysis applies. We cannot mix domains. Mixing domains is impossible. In trying to do so, we'll have catastrophic results, especially for things like grades on tests. That means the first step of any phasor analysis problem is going to be to get everything over to the phasor domain. So starting with the time domain expressions, we need to convert them to the phasor domain to do analysis. If this is a cosine function, this is as simple as writing the magnitude times the exponential function raised to j times the phase angle. If our time domain expression is a sine function, we will have to change it to cosine by subtracting 90 degrees from the argument. Then we can write it as a magnitude and phase angle. If the original function has no phase angle, then the phasor expression would be the magnitude times e to the j zero. A little aside about notation. In books and in print, phasors are denoted by a capital letter in bold text. This is not very easy or efficient to do by hand. How I denote phasor quantities in handwritten work is by drawing an extra line on the letters representing phasors. So the time domain function x of t I draw as a capital X with a double line on one of the lines forming the letter. Similarly, a voltage v of t would be written as a capital V with an extra line, and a current I of t would be a capital I with a double line. In the phasor domain, we're dealing with complex numbers. That means we have two ways of expressing each of our quantities, polar and rectangular. So we can take each of the polar phasors that we just wrote and convert them to rectangular form using Euler's formula. So 170 e to the j 120 degrees volts becomes minus 85 plus j 147 volts. The current of 1.2 e to the minus j 28 degrees amps would become 1.06 minus j 0.56 amps. And 23 e to the j 0 degrees microamps would become 23 plus j 0 microamps. Remember, rectangular form is necessary for operations of addition and subtraction. Often after we have completed a phasor domain analysis, we will need to write the function in the time domain again. This is fairly straightforward from a polar phasor. However, if we start in rectangular form, we will need to first convert the phasor to polar form before we can convert it to the time domain. The magnitude will be the square root of the sum of the squares of the components. The angle will be the tangent inverse of the imaginary part over the real part. Keep in mind that a positive imaginary component and a negative real component put this in the second quadrant, so the angle has to be between 90 degrees and 180 degrees. Some calculators do not differentiate between a negative sign in the numerator and a negative sign in the denominator. In that case, the calculator would return a value of negative 60 degrees, which is in the wrong quadrant. We always have to check our angles to make sure that the calculator gave us the correct value. Performing these calculations, we will find that the polar representation is 169.8 e to the j 120 degrees volts, which when rounded becomes a 170 e to the j 120 degrees volts. Then to go from the phasor domain to the time domain, we simply put the magnitude and the phase angle into the cosine function and remember the angular frequency of the original function. I wrote the angular frequency a little bit differently this time so that it's easier to see the cyclical frequency of 60 Hertz. Now that we know how to convert functions between time and phasor domains, we see that phasor techniques can be used to add two cosine functions. We could, I suppose, try to add these functions together using trigonometric identities and such, but that sounds rather painful. Phasor analysis will allow us to add these functions together in a straightforward way. I will admit, when we were first doing this, because of the large number of steps, it does not look much easier. With practice, the steps become second nature and can be gone through very quickly. The procedure to add two functions together together is as follows. The first thing we have to do is to verify both cosine functions have the same angular frequency. Once that is verified, we can convert from the time domain to the phasor domain. Addition of complex numbers cannot be done in polar form, so we will have to convert each of these to rectangular form. Once we have the function written in rectangular form, we simply add the real components and the imaginary components together to get a single rectangular phasor. We then convert the rectangular phasor to polar form by using our established procedure. Remember to check the angle. A negative real part and a positive imaginary part should give us an angle that puts us in the second quadrant. If our calculator returns a value for the angle that puts us in the fourth quadrant, we need to add 180 degrees in order to get the correct angle. One more aside, always express angles with values between 180 and minus 180 degrees. Using the smallest angle that accurately describes the quantity makes interpreting the angle easier, so it communicates more effectively. A phase angle of 10,348 degrees may be technically correct for some problem, but it does not effectively communicate anything. Once we have our phasor in polar form, converting it back to the time domain simply involves looking back to the original function to remind ourselves of the angular frequency and then writing the magnitude and phase angle into our cosine function. So now we have phasors as a mathematical tool. Next time we'll have to take a look to see how this might apply to circuit analysis. Sinusoidal steady state analysis, or phasor analysis, is a tool that we will use to analyze circuits with single frequency sinusoidal sources. Using phasor techniques, we can add sinusoidal functions together. In order to do that, we must start with cosine functions that we will convert from the time domain to the phasor domain. Once we're in the phasor domain, to add functions together, we need to convert to rectangular form. Once we have performed the addition, we convert back to polar form and then back to the time domain. At first blush, this may seem a little cumbersome, but I promise you it will greatly simplify our analysis of circuits that contain sinusoidal sources and energy storage devices. That's all for today. Go out and make it a great one.